Right, welcome back. You can find us on the Twitters at the FF Dynasty. You can hit us up individually at Jay Wayne's World, at Dynasty Big Co, at IMC Myers. Be sure to go check out the website, theffdynasty.com. Lots of fun stuff over there.
Some upgrades. Jay Wayne got the pencil and the eraser out over the weekend and did some customization. Just looking pimp.
Spent a lot of time in there.
Yeah, really working out the kinks.
All right, you ready to get to this next go round here?
Yeah. Well, we mentioned this question in the as we were getting started tonight. We got a interesting question out of the Patreon community. Got a startup coming and some pretty good details in a pretty unique league. I've heard bits and pieces of this types of league, but I haven't heard all this put together like this. And it's a pretty much a theory question, a startup question, and I thought it'd be a really good question for us to talk about on the show here. So he said, got the big, it's a $500 league coming up. He said, I'm kind of struggling to figure out how I'm going to go about it. He said, I might want to go all in, and this is why. It's an Empire League, which I never really heard it called that before, but I know the focus of it. One of our homes leagues plays the same way. If you win back-to-back championships, you take down a progressive pot. But this one, in addition to that, also starts over if somebody wins 2 years in a row. So he said, with the rules being like that, he's thinking about a redraft-like strategy, wondering if that's the way to go, swing for the fences out of the gate, trying to win those first two championships. And basically he's saying, is it right for me to be thinking to go older players that are producing and maybe even trade away some of my 2020 picks? He thinks that there's going to be a couple teams out there that's going to draft super young and pass on the, you know, production and get some young players and maybe even go, as Ryan McDowell puts it, into the productive struggle mode in the first season or two. So he thinks that'll take a couple teams out of the championship contention right off the rip. And and this is actually not a bad thing, bad way he puts it. He said, hey, if I go all in to win it early and it doesn't work out, but somebody else wins it early and it works out for them, then the whole thing's over anyway. So I didn't really waste my time.
Start over with a new fresh team.
It's an expensive venture, though.
It is an expensive venture. I like where his head's at. And he says, basically, am I seeing this right or am I taking crazy pills? And my gut reaction reading all this, $500, like Jay Wayne said, that's pretty expensive. The thing about it is, it is hard to win a championship in any league. It's very hard to win two in a row. If you haven't ever been the best team in the league and barely missed the playoffs due to total points or win-loss record or something like that, you just haven't been playing fantasy football that long. If you haven't, and vice versa, if you haven't ever been like 13-3 and knowing your team's barely even good,
yeah,
just because of the luck. Like, there's so much luck in a week-to-week fantasy football league. If you go into this, like, I have no problem coming out of a dynasty startup with no rookies on my team.
Yeah.
But to say that my strategy is going to go in and just take all the old guys who are definitely doing work right now, like Juju Smith-Schuster is 21 years old. He's doing work, you know? So you don't have to just say, I'm going to take all the veterans. There's plenty of guys that are really, like Davante Adams, he's super young, super awesome. Like, I don't think there's any reason you can't go into this league and say, I'm going to try to hit, everybody's trying to hit on every pick, but you know, like a Corey Davis or somebody in the third round when he was a rookie, you're taking a stab on somebody who you think's going to be awesome, but you've never seen him play.
Right.
You know, you don't have to go, I would have no problem going 8 full rounds into this league without drafting a rookie, mm-hmm. but I don't have to be drafting 29-year-old players. Right. It's basically how I see this. Like your five, I love going after the championships early, but you can go after championships with, you know, a couple of whoever you're everybody's going to get studs in the first two rounds because that's just how it works. Mm-hmm. Then maybe you get your Kerryon Johnson in the third round. That's a swing at the fence, but also he's 21 years old and his value is going to be awesome no matter what.
Yeah.
So even if he's not working out perfectly in your first year, his trade value is going to be pretty insulated.
Yeah.
You know, that's my first gut reaction to reading this question. How do you feel about it,
Jay Wayne?
Well, It's a $500 league, so that's a ton of money, right? I'm not in any leagues that cost that much. So if I was going to get in one like that, and I think it's an interesting structure where, you know, if you win twice, it's all done. and it's and everyone starts over, and I like that in this $500 league. I don't know that I'd really approach my draft much different. I don't think that I would be counting on someone winning that thing two times in a row so I can just go willy-nilly in a, with a redraft type of mentality. I'm going to be cautious enough that I still have a good team if this thing never breaks up. So maybe you take, you know, maybe you take a David Johnson over a younger running back that isn't quite as productive as David Johnson. So maybe you take the guys that are like a little bit older over someone that is younger with more ceiling, right? Potential, but you haven't really seen it.
Right, exactly.
So, you know, maybe I don't take Galladay and maybe, you know, maybe I don't take these younger guys that I'm waiting to, or Corey Davis. Like we've been, Corey Davis has been in the second, third round for years now, waiting for him to become something. Maybe I don't mess with that guy. And instead I take, you know, I don't have a good example in front of me, but I mean, you know, an AJ Green or something. Like maybe I take something I know.
Well, maybe a highly productive Cooper Kupp. Cooper Kupp's right there beside Corey Davis. He doesn't have Corey Davis name equity, but Cooper Kupp is scoring points every week in your lineup.
Or T.Y. Hilton. You know, maybe I'm more in on T.Y. whereas in a different type of scenario, I might pass on T.Y. and look for something a little younger, even though I'm still in on T.Y. regardless.
Okay, I feel you.
But you know, maybe I'm not as afraid to take a little bit older dude. But I'm still trying to build a good dynasty, and I still want someone that's going to be good long term. I mean, no matter what league I'm playing in, we're trying to operate in like a 3-year window, so I'm not just going crazy youth for no reason. I don't know that my mentality would. I would caution just going in there with a redraft mentality.
Yeah, and like I would. I don't think it changes a ton for me, and maybe I'm completely wrong about it, but like I'm number one, I'm not necessarily drafting my team to lose. I'm trying to win most times when I draft my team, and sometimes after the first year, you're sitting there going, this is a little bit more of a project than I originally anticipated, but I'm typically not drafting unless things get sideways and it's in an auction and maybe I just missed out on a couple of guys and now all of a sudden I'm looking at my team a little differently because people outspent on me and I realized that, hey, I should have won another dollar or two on Zeke or, you know, something along those lines. Yeah. And that happens. Like sometimes you have to alter your strategy in an auction, but I feel like in most times in a snake draft, like I can kind of almost stay on top of it. Somebody might snake a guy from you here or there, but it's not like you just kept getting beat up by a couple bucks on the guy and you just were getting stubborn and were like, I'm not gonna spend any more money.
Right.
So I don't know if it's an auction or a snake draft to start off with, which would change my strategy a little bit.
You're right. You don't get beat up as much in a snake draft because it's laid out in front of you.
I feel like there's not as much immediate regrets. Like you kind of know what you're getting into a little. You just never know what's going to happen in the auction. Like somebody could just be so into something. And then for the other thing is like I think I would maybe be a little bit more versed in getting like a really good tight end in this league, and I'd be like a little more attacking that, and maybe even like I would probably be a little bit more in trying to get like a really good younger quarterback.
Maybe not even younger, but I mean obviously Patrick Mahomes would be fantastic.
I don't know. But I don't think too much changes for me. Like, I still want some youth. I still want to be able to take, if maybe instead of cultivating my youth, then I'm immediately selling a lot of my youth and trying to bring in those veterans that I know are already good.
Yeah.
Which, you know, we're doing a lot anyway. But maybe I'm kind of hyper on that in this scenario where I'm like, hey, this guy's coming up. Maybe he's going to be good. Maybe he's not. I'm not going to take any chances on these. I don't have a good example, but like a guy who could be a flash in the pan guy, maybe you need to sell, right? Or maybe like Tyreek Hill a couple of years ago.
When you weren't
sure. Maybe I'll hang on, maybe I won't. Like now I'm just, see ya. Like,
yeah.
Just let me get something that I know is good for sure in this league. That if I feel like I'm ready to roll, like if I feel like I'm ready to make a push at this particular juncture, then.
Well, two things there.
There'd be nobody better on your team than Tyreek Hill, though, case.
Right, but.
But how many, the Tom Montgomery.
I'm just saying, like you were saying, let's mitigate some risk on the initial draft. I might mitigate some risk on the up and comers.
Right. I like what
somewhere
you
whereas usually I'm kind of in the middle, like I'll take some risk and not take some risk on those guys.
I like what you said there about trying to get maybe a Travis Kelce or an Ertz or a Kittle or somebody like that.
Not that I'm not trying to get those.
Right.
But I might be geared a little bit more towards a guy who's going to anchor that position for a long time.
And give yourself, I mean, like
an advantage.
Talk about it a lot recently on the Patreon show with some trade questions. I mean, you got an advantage with one of those top tight ends over the next three tight ends, not just tight ends 9, 10, 11, 12. Mm-hmm. Like those top three or four tight ends have an advantage over the top. Over the 5, 6, and 7
right.
every week. And then you're killing the guy in your tight end spot. If you're not playing against one of those other three or four good guys, you're crushing the people unless they get just super lucky and the tight end 12 that week happens to score 2 touchdowns. But the other thing you said was you're not drafting your team to lose and the productive struggle thing. We have one of our shared dynasty leagues on FFPC. It comes to mind after you said that was this one guy 2 years ago when we were in a startup. His first pick, I remember it because he ended up it was an obvious productive struggle because he ended up trading half of his picks into startup for first round picks, but he took Mike Evans in the first round and then Todd Gurley and then basically traded his whole team away for all kinds of first round picks and then drafted a bunch of young guys, but that team ended up crushing it because I think if memory serves, he got the 1-1-2. So like now he's got Saquon and Gurley and Mike Evans and a bunch of good players. But that being said, I've seen more than a handful of teams do that, and also and now they're
just
not
go
good.
Off the rails.
They got one or two good players, and then they just got a bunch of bad
just
players.
Just send your money in.
Right, exactly. So for the one really absolute home run cut team that I've seen that made the productive struggle work, I've seen 5 or 6 more that
and it's
were
usually
just
not
that terrible
quick
teams.
Either. Like it's usually not as quick as
right.
Maybe
the Gurley
that happened.
Gurley was a just a quick turnaround,
turnaround
being the best.
And then you get Saquon
back.
And mm-hmm. some. You know, maybe you hit on another player or two.
Yeah, and to kind of tie all that together, if you're a confident guy, like last year going into my startup, there was nobody that was going to draft Robert Woods before me. If you're confident in the back end of your draft,
sure.
Like I put together a team where I took some swings and I missed in the first round. I put together a team that had Le'Veon Bell and David Johnson on it. Obviously, Le'Veon Bell never played, and David Johnson had an awful season based on what the expectations were. But I put together the Robert Woods and the Emmanuel Sanders and those types of players in the back half of the draft that each and every week I had a team scoring points. Like if you're confident in the way you can draft at the back of the draft, then you can go up and get that Patrick Mahomes type, Andrew Luck mm-hmm. type, awesome quarterback that's going to give you advantage from week to week, grab you that tight end, and then pile on good players, which, you know, probably not many people take a quarterback and a tight end early, which you usually shouldn't, but given the way tight ends dominate – and quarterbacks can help you win
in a
short window.
And the influx of all this running back talent recently has really like just added a ton of players to be able to draw from.
Exactly. Exactly.
Like double the amount of good running backs last 2 years.
Definitely a very unique and very interesting type league, and we'll be staying in touch with this guy's draft as it moves forward and hopefully doing our best to help him out with his $500 startup. But I thought that would be a good kick it around the room type question for the podcast here.
Yeah, just a little bit of insight of stuff we do on Patreon. We'll be staying on that guy and talking to that guy more and more about what's going on and what to do as we mull that over. There's a couple of details that we left out of there because they weren't exactly clear and we didn't get a follow-up answer from them. But just wanted to give you a little bit of insight of what we do on the Pleasure Chest is what we call our premium awesomeness show. It's premium content. Bitco doesn't like the word content all
of
a sudden.
I love it. Thanks for that. And also there was one of the responses to this question was from another listener, and he said that he plays in an Empire format just like that, and they're in year five of the league. And it's basically the same rules. And he said he's won twice, but not in a row. He said it's talk about how tough it is to win 2 years in a row and don't draft your team just going all vets because it is that tough to actually make that happen. But then he also says, and the reason I'm bringing all this up is because he brings in this point of if this gets you thinking about starting a league like this with your friends or whatever, this extra rule that he says and is in his league is the champion, because in the way that the Empire means is if you win 2 in a row, the league resets and you redraft teams, and the person that won 2 years in a row makes a lot more money than a normal championship would pay you. that after the first, if, when somebody is the reigning champion, the year that they're trying to win it, the second year in a row, that team is not allowed to trade with anybody because of the potential for conspiracies and all that stuff and going in and some backroom deals saying, hey, if Jay Wayne and I wanted to get together, if Jay Wayne had won and I said, okay, Jay Wayne, I'm gonna give you a lopsided trade over here because if you win 2 years in a row now, then you make a lot of money, you split, you give me some of it, and the league starts over, so I'm not penalized for the bad trade because I get to get a new team too. So Sean throws that out there as a response, and I think that's a really cool that wouldn't work if it was just you win two times in a row and you get extra money, but the league keeps going,
right?
Because why would I want to give all my good players to Jay and then suck next year,
right?
But in a league that starts over, that's a great rule, and I'm glad he put that in there.
Yeah. All right, well,
yeah, that should wrap up today's show. So if you guys are listening, please head over to iTunes, give us a little 5-star review, hit subscribe on YouTube. Definitely check out the webpage. Added some player pages on there, so just for rookies that we've covered up to this point. So definitely search around on there. Give me some feedback. I put a new search bar at the top of the screen, so if you can start typing any player's name in, and it'll suggest options for you for anything that we've posted about it. And if you look for one of those rookies that we've already covered, you can find the player page, and it'll show you. Give you a link to our specific breakdown, some college game logs, links to different tape you can watch, all kind of stuff. So definitely check that out. Give me some feedback if you find any errors or something doesn't work here or there. Put a
Shoot
lot of different
email.
Work in. Definitely hit us up, theffdynasty@gmail.com. And if you're looking for some more content, we put another hour.
Awesomeness.
Another premium awesomeness hour of the Pleasure Chest.
Super head terrific over, happy hour.
Head over to patreon.com/theffdynasty. And
see you next week.
We'll see you next time.
Deuces.
Or maybe not next week.
The FF Dynasty's Married to the Game.